Good morning. Welcome to Trinity United Methodist Church. We're glad you're here this Lord's Day.
Worship that you will find printed in the bulletin. The psalmist sings, "One thing I asked of the Lord that I will seek after." Sisters and brothers, God is good, and in love and mercy greets us here.
Thank you.
opening prayer this morning is found in the bulletin. Please pray with me. Loving God, you save all who seek refuge in you. Grant that we who know your salvation may walk away in your light, take courage in your faithfulness, and rejoice in your astounding goodness to us. Through Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Francis Betjeman will lead us in our Psalter this morning. It is Psalm 27. It is found on page 758.
Is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes shall stumble and fall.
Though a host encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident.
One thing I ask of the Lord that I will seek after.
That I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in the Lord's temple.
The Lord will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble, will conceal me under the cover of his tent, and will set me high upon a rock.
And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies round about me, and I will offer sacrifices in the Lord's tent with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord.
O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me.
Come, my heart said, seek the Lord's face. Your face, O Lord, I seek.
Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger, for you have been my help.
Cast me not off, forsake me not, O God.
Way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies.
Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out vows.
I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. And at this time, I invite Steve Reynolds, the chairperson of our Finance Committee, as well as Paula Stover, the chairperson of our Stewardship Committee, to come and offer us a report.
My name is Steve Reynolds, and in January, I became chairman of your Finance Committee. I've been asked to report to you on our current budget and financial status. To explain where we are, I need to tell you a bit of background on how we got here. As most of you know, the Finance Committee prepares a budget annually and submits to the Church Council for approval. In late 2017, Church Council approved a 2018 budget for Trinity of $932,000. Now, hindsight can even make somebody as slow as me look intelligent. And in hindsight, that was a budget we could not really reasonably expect to fund. Fortunately, we realized that in limited spending, only spending $857,000 in 2018, but we still ran a $60,000 deficit for the year. But that brings us to 2019. Work area requests made in late 2018 for the 2019 budget were $988,000, a figure we could not hope to reach. Now, we love our work areas. These folks are passionate to do God's will and reach people for Christ. So the Finance Committee was faced with disappointing some of our very best workers. But that's how it goes. We looked at what we could reasonably expect to fund. Giving in 2018 was $797,000. And there was no reason to expect a substantial increase. We said $800,000. But there was some good news. As many of you know, we have a substantial endowment, if you will, of a bit over $1.1 million. Those funds are restricted. They can be used for various purposes, but not for operating expenses like utilities, supplies, and salaries, which is what makes up the annual budget. With one caveat, we can use earnings from the investment accounts with approval of Church Council. There were earnings available, and Church Council authorized the transfer of $50,000 to the operating budget. That brought us to $850,000, still a long way from $988,000. Our work areas and staff undertook the painful task of reworking their requests and did a magnificent job, reducing requests by $100,000 to $888,000, but we're still $38,000 short. Joseph, Paula, Roy Creech, and I met to see what we could do, and it was Roy who spoke up. He and Paula would appeal for more funds from you saints and fund the $38,000. I hope many of you will join Eve Marie and me in trying to do a little extra and make this work. Our budget funds many exciting and worthwhile projects, but has no salary increases. $888,000 is a lot of money to do God's work, and I report that through the end of February, we have collected about $179,000 and have a $70,000 surplus as of the end of the month, not including the $50,000 contribution from investments. That actually sounds better than it really is. Giving has over the last several years dropped substantially during the summer, so this is where we at least need to be at this time. It is an imposingly difficult task to decide how to use our resources so we can further God's kingdom on earth and please Him. To construct a budget that will please all our members and work is not imposingly difficult, it is in fact impossible. The Finance Committee will closely monitor and tweak as necessary during the year, all being approved by Church Council, which has the final say. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your support of the work and the ministry of Trinity United Methodist Church.
And I'm Paula Stover, and I'm the stewardship chair. And Roy and I need $38,000. I'm just teasing. I'm here to tell you about our stewardship committee. So until last year, we didn't really have a stewardship committee. And it doesn't seem that long ago, last fall, that you saw me stand here or there or somewhere and talk about Joe Ash's box and tell you that God would provide. If we just look at the numbers that Steve just presented, it doesn't seem like that's true, but he did. He provided us with a good and tenacious finance chairman who knows how to cut a budget, who knows how to give us wisdom to look at it. God provided us with wisdom and ways that we could cut without cutting into our ministries and our discipleship. So we put together a stewardship committee this year that's really exciting. It's comprised of Henry Moses, Sally Artis, Jana Jackson, Cammie Chandler, Julie Baldiff, and Charlie Pope. And what we hope to do is look for ways to equip us, Trinity, to live out God's call for us to be good stewards. One of the things that we're looking at is to increase our online giving presence. When we do a church budget, we divide it evenly, the total amount, in 12-month increments, but that's not really the way it happens in ministry. There are times like the Living Christmas Story and Vacation Bible School where there's increased need. Vacation Bible School comes about just about the time that all of you all in your checkbooks go to the beach for the summer, or the lake for the summer, or the mountains for the summer. So there are things to consider like that, but God is faithful, and He gives us ways to accommodate. And so just like we live the rest of our lives, we're looking into mobile apps and text to give for special giving and things that will make it easier for us to live out that covenantal relationship with God that is our stewardship. We want to find creative ways to inform you and us and the neighborhood, the community, about, you know, how do we share with you all how we use our gifts for ministry and discipleship, and what do we need to carry out God's vision for us. So we ask that you pray with us about these things, that you would give us feedback. Anybody that's on the stewardship committee that I just read, Roy and myself, Joseph, Angela, Steve, if you have ideas, wants, needs, if God speaks to you about stewardship, please let us know. Join us in this. You'll be hearing from us along and along this year. Stewardship is not just a campaign in the fall to ask for money. So we ask that you would join us and be good stewards with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Paula and Steve. At this time, I would invite our children who are present to come forward for children's moments with me. Y'all are still sleeping. Good morning. There you are. It's good to see all of you. And so many of you have on your green. I like that. I see that. You've got green. So this morning, we're going to be reading some more scripture. We read some scripture with Miss Frances Betchman as we read our psalm and we sang the psalm, the Psalter. But we're going to be reading some more scripture from the Old Testament, the book of Genesis. Hold on just a second. And when we read that scripture from Genesis, we're going to hear about how someone called God their shield. Hey, do y'all know what a shield is? Do you know what a shield looks like? What's a shield look like? It might look like a couple of different things, but what? Why would you carry a shield? Who carries a shield? A knight, that's right. Not like day and night, but a knight who protects and fights, right? All right. So maybe someone that looks a little bit like this. Yeah? Is that someone who has a shield? Yeah, that's a big shield, isn't it? You see how big that shield is? So we're going to be reading scripture about how God is their shield. Now, what in the world is a shield used for? Protection. That's exactly right. And so as we read in Genesis, it's going to be talking about how God is our protector. Now, that guy, even though he's in all of this armor and he's protected and he's got a sword, he's still going to need that shield, isn't he? It's going to help him whenever there are those that come after him, or whenever he sees things or encounters things that he needs to push through, he can use that shield as part of his protection. Now, how many of you have ever been afraid? I have. I'm afraid sometimes, and sometimes I'm afraid of the fact that all of the lights have been turned out. Does anybody else get a little bit? Yep, you too? He has a hat, yes. Do y'all get a little uneasy whenever all the lights are out? You do? Okay, my buddy, we're in this together. So oftentimes whenever I was younger, I would turn the lights off and I would run to the next room. Have you ever done that? Well, one night I was having trouble turning my night light off. You do, you do, I know. And we have night lights, don't we? We have night lights. Well, I have to remember. Yes, it's on while you sleep, that's right. So we have these night lights that are a reminder to us that it doesn't have to be completely dark. What I want you to think about is that God is our protector. That sometimes, hold on, I'm gonna let you talk in just a minute, okay? So we have all of these things that remind us that we're gonna be okay. When we're afraid, what helps you remember that you're safe? God. Mm-hmm. God does remind us. Do you have people in your life that remind you that you're safe and you're protected? Do your parents? Yeah? Maybe all of these things. Hold on just a minute. All of these things help us remember that we are protected. And a lot of times our parents do. Well, I want you to remember that God is your shield and your protector also. Hold on just a minute. God is your shield and your protector. And that anything that you face that might be scary or anything that you need protection from, to remember that God is with you and God protects you, and count and rely on God. Let's give God thanks. Can you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for being my protector. Help me to remember that you are always with me. We love you. Amen. Thank you. scripture reading comes from Genesis, the 15th chapter, beginning with the first verse. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward the heaven and count the stars, if you're able to count them. And then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur to the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? And he said to him, Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all these and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other. But he did not cut the birds in two. And when birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your descendants I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. You may be seated. Let us pray. We thank you, O Lord, for being our strength and our shield. Be present among us here in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. It seems so much for so little. So much to be done for a private and silent word. Before our reading for today, Abram, who we would later know as Abraham, left his home and his family of origin, all of the folks that he had grown up with, because God told him to go. And he went. He and Sarai, his wife, all of his slaves, and his nephew Lot. And just on the voice, just on the leading of God, they left. And they wandered as far as Egypt. And he tried to be faithful. Even as he dealt with numerous kings of varied lands in battle and negotiation. And then we come to the chapter and verse of today that Angela read. And it starts out, and after all of these things. God speaks to Abram yet again and tells him not to be afraid, that he will be his shield. But Abram's been through a lot. He's done a lot. And because he has no heir, he has no children of his own to fulfill what God has promised, he's beginning to wonder, what's this going to look like? How would he have the stamina to conquer so many foes to claim the promised land? How would Sarai, his wife, and Abram bear a child? He had answered the call, but now he wanted specifics. So God invites him to step outside and count the stars in the sky. And as Abram looks up, God tells him that these will be the number of your descendants. The writer of Genesis says it is reckoned to him as righteousness that he believed what God had said. But still, there is this nagging in his heart. Because his next statement is a question. How will I know? How will I know that these things will take place? Abram's question echoes what's in the secret chambers of our souls. Because there comes a time in life that we want the particulars. We want the facts. We want the figures. We want to be able to measure the specifics. We want a plan of action. Where's the beef? But the problem is that sometimes we get lost in that kind of circumstance of looking for the plan. We get lost in the minutiae of the moment and the forest of detail, trying to work it out, trying to see how God will do it. And sometimes that becomes a stumbling block for our faith. And Abram asks, how will I know? And as a response to Abram's question, God tells him, go and get these various animals that Angela listed so well. And Abram did this. And as he's gathering these animals, he's got an idea of what's going to happen. Because when you gathered those specific animals, when you were in negotiations with someone, there would be one thing that would happen. And it was what we would call a covenant. Now, covenant in the ancient language meant cut. And notice what Abram does to the animals. He cuts them in two. And here's the thing. There was a part in that agreement, in that covenant. It wasn't done on 1,000 pages of paper. It was done in this way. The ancients would get together and they would cut those animals in two, and each party would walk between those scattered animals, those torn carcasses. And that would be a declaration that said, may I be cut in half like this if I don't keep the covenant that I make this day. So Abram gathers all of these animals with the expectation that there will be a time when God commands him to walk in between the cut halves of the animals. So he stands by. He waits and he waits. I can only imagine what it smelled like with those dead carcasses. He drove away the vultures and other predators away from the carcasses. He waited so long. And then twilight came, and he's still waiting. And night comes, and he's still waiting. The book of Genesis says that Abram goes to sleep while he's waiting as it gets darker. But then Genesis gives us another couple of sentences, phrases that are quite interesting, actually. He talks about another darkness that comes. It's a darkness that has nothing to do with the earth's rotation. Abram goes through what the NRSV says, is what Angela read, as a deep and terrifying darkness. Even as he's sleeping, he is going through this deep and terrifying darkness. Now, the Message version of the Bible, I like that translation sometimes. And what it says here is that Abram goes through a sense of dread. Dark and heavy. A sense of dread. Dark and heavy. Because you see, the question that he asked, the question that we ask, is not just a question that speaks to the concerns of the circumstances of our lives. It speaks to more than just our desire for a roadmap going forward. God, how are we to do this? It speaks more than just about the divine control of our lives. How will I know also addresses the condition of the dread within us. There are times in this we want circumstances and we want answers and we want the path and we have doubts. But sometimes our doubts are not about God. Sometimes the doubts that we have are about ourselves. There are times I read these words from Abram. I think they're questioning his own, or covering his own doubts when he's questioning God. And some of those questions are our questions. Lord, I'm just an old guy from Sumter or Hemingway. I'm just a kid in high school. I'm just a woman. I'm just a. How can I live up to what you expect? Sometimes our doubts are not about God, but they are about us. How could I claim a land when I don't have the stamina of a man that's half my age? Lord, what if I fail? Lord, what if I can't do what you expect me to do? Some of our doubts are not about God, but they're about us. We have those self-doubts. We have that sense of dread, and dare I say, we also suffer from depression. Now, you or someone you love may suffer through depression. And it could take you into some mighty dark places. Places where you are robbed of joy and the fullness of life. So on top of the questioning and doubts about about circumstance that Abram has, he's also got this dread of the darkness in his own soul, I suspect. And that we can see in our own selves and those around us. So here is Abram sitting in the dark beneath a starry sky, groping for the specifics to answer the circumstances before him.
grappling with a sense of dread within his very soul. And he's waiting. Is God going to ask him to walk between the covenant carcasses? He's already stepped out in faith once. Is this the time he would have to do it again? In the omitted part of the reading for today, those verses that come between, God tells Abram about how things would not get any better for a while, that his direct descendants would know slavery for 400 years, but eventually they would be triumphant. And he also reassures Abram that he himself would go to his grave in peace. Does God offer him hopeful specifics? Does God give Abram a roadmap? Would God give a healing word for his dread? And as we and he perhaps are asking those questions, it is in that moment that Abram sees a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passing between the animal pieces. A flame so bright that it lights the whole night. Holy smoke so fragrant that it fills the whole area with a sense of the holy. In that flaming torch and in that smoking fire pot come the presence of God. God passes among the pieces. And here was a sign for Abram and for us that God would be torn apart if God did not keep the covenant with Abram, with humanity, and with us. We follow a God willing to put God's own self on the line for us. Between the animal pieces in Abram's time and on the cross of Jesus on Calvary's height. As the people of God and all of our humanity, you and I will have times in our faith where we are burdened by the desire for specifics of how things are going to work out. I wish I could tell you. I wish I could tell you, Steve, how we're going to find $38,000. But I know God will find a way. There will be times that we want those specifics. There'll be times when we want to micromanage the circumstances of our life. Times that we want to move in the direction of the known and managed outcomes that we can plan. And yet, God does not give us specifics. God gives himself in covenant relationship. God is faithful to God's word and relationship to us because God has much more to lose if God does not keep the covenant. And because God loves us so much and puts so much on the line from that relationship, we, you, and I can live the next steps, the next moments of life. As Francis read the words of the psalmist, God is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? So we can move forward in the circumstances of our lives. But we could also take comfort. For the dark night of the soul where we feel dread or self-doubt or depression. We can take comfort, for in the light we follow a light that pierces our darkest times. God's light is there even when we are so depressed that we cannot hold our heads high enough to see it. God is still there. God is a light that comes to us and believes in us even when we doubt ourselves. God's light is a light that glows with unconditional love for us even when we hate ourselves. God doesn't just pass between the torn animal carcasses of Abram's time. God passes among and with the torn and tortured human souls of this day and age. Whatever the circumstance before you now, as you live and plot for the next days ahead, whatever the condition there is within you, hear the good news. God is present. And may you find the peace of God today in all of the circumstances and conditions of your life. You may not see a smoking fire pot or a flaming torch, but God's presence and peace will find a way to be known in your life, in the living of your life today. Be attentive. As Abraham was attentive. Be blessed. As Abraham was blessed. And may the love and assurance of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be your light and salvation in all of the circumstances and conditions of your daily life. Amen. Now, as a response to the word of God proclaimed among us, let us recite the Apostles' Creed, the traditional version, found on page 881. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
This morning, as we prepare to go to God in prayer together as one body, we ask that you continue to remember all those who are listed in the bulletin, those who are heavy on our hearts, and especially today, we ask that you continue to remember all those who have been affected by the violence in New Zealand, all those who lost their lives, and all those who lost those whom they love. We also ask that you please continue to remember all those who are ill. Joseph's mom, Miss Ann, had a short little rendezvous at Prisma this weekend, but she will be coming home today, and we are grateful for that. But asking prayers for continued health. And many of you have probably been like me and have worn more pigtails in the last 2 months than you did growing up, whatever your age. And they will still continue as we continue to pray for Peyton. Peyton is doing well and she is home. And her family has given us a gift that as we prepare to go to God in prayer, that they would share a short video with us. So if you would.
And the blood will dry underneath my nails, and the wind will rise up to fill my sails. So you can doubt and you can hate, but I know no matter what it takes, I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home. Let the rain wash away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming. Still far away from where I belong, but it's always darkest before the dawn. So you can doubt and you can hate, but I know no matter what it takes, I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home. Let the rain wash away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home. Let the rain wash away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell
Jenny. Let us go to God in prayer. God of glory and love, you lifted up your Son, Jesus Christ, from the earth to draw all people to your holy name. Like grains of wheat that fall to the dust, teach us to die to self so that we might bear much fruit, giving our lives for the sake of the gospel as we follow and serve Christ. You are a God of love that knows no boundaries. Forgive us when we crowd our lives with so much activity that it's hard to find time for you. Forgive us when we become so focused on ourselves that we overlook those around us who are searching for hope. Forgive us when we end up filling our hearts' spiritual emptiness with junk rather than feasting on your word. Forgive us. Open our eyes to see your covenant written in plain sight on our hearts. Open our hearts that we may join you in serving the broken of the world. Open our love, so that we may pour it out as abundantly and graciously as your love is given to us. Have mercy on us, O God, and in your great compassion, hear our prayers. We cry out to you for our broken world and for those who seek their own way through violence and threat. We pray to you for ones who have been wounded by the recent acts of violence, young and old, at home or on vacation. Heal their bodies and their hearts. Comfort them with your presence. In the same time, take away any hatred and desire for revenge. We pray that you would draw near and comfort the families and friends of those who have lost their lives. Enable them in your mercy to seek refuge in you as they grieve. We pray for the Muslim community in New Zealand and around the world. that you would protect them from unjust aggression and discrimination. We pray that you would touch the hearts of those who commit acts of terror, that they may recognize the evil of their actions and would turn to the way of peace and goodness, of respect for the life and dignity of every human being, regardless of religion, origin, gender, race, wealth, or poverty. We pray for your church, all leaders and ministers, and all the holy people of God. We ask that you would lead us here at Trinity in such a way that all we do will bring glory to your name and shine a light in the dark places of the world. We pray for those who are ill, those in pain, those who grieve, those under stress, those bound by addiction, and those who are lonely. Give to them the joy of your saving help and your compassion as you sustain them with the presence of your Holy Spirit. And today, O God, we offer you the sweetest praise and thanksgiving for the healing that has been witnessed through little Peyton. Continue to strengthen her and her family in their journey to a life of health and fullness. And in this season of Lent, create in each of us clean hearts and renew a right spirit within us, that as we prepare our hearts to remember the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, grant us the strength and wisdom to serve and follow you this day and always. We ask this all in the precious name of Jesus, whom we love. Amen. I would invite the ushers to come forward as we offer God's tithe and our offering.
Gracious God, we thank you for the opportunity you give us to give of our lives, to give of our energy, to give of our resources. And we pray, O Lord, that all of these things may be used to further your kingdom in this world, in this place. And we ask these things, O Lord, in the name of the one who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, stand firm in the Lord.
The God of reconciliation bless you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you. And the power of the Holy Spirit strengthen you this day and forevermore. Amen.